More countries are joining a diplomatic boycott of the Beijing Olympics, and mixed messages are coming out of Beijing. On one hand, it accuses the nations of politicizing the games. On the other, Beijing says it doesn't care if they attend. But that's not the only boycott happening. China is now snubbing Lithuania for strengthening its ties to Taiwan. The European Union responds, saying it's ready to stand up against all types of political pressure from China's communist regime. Members of China's Communist Party have a new personal obligation to have 3 kids. That's according to a state media editorial, requiring party members to help boost the country's birth rate and relieve its population crisis. And Chinese authorities are disqualifying independent candidates from running in an election. This, as Beijing claims, it embraces a better style of democracy than the U.S. Welcome to China in Focus. I'm Tiffany Meyer. More countries are joining the diplomatic boycott of the Beijing Olympics. On one hand, China is sharply criticizing these countries, threatening they'll pay a price for their actions. But on the other hand, Beijing also says it doesn't care. An Australian senator is calling Beijing's reaction childish. Let's take a look.
In Europe, France and Germany say they need to take a united front toward Beijing, related to a diplomatic boycott of 2022 Winter Olympics.
We are in favor of a common position. We will see what is at stake during the next foreign ministers' meeting or the next one. But this question needs to be dealt with as Europeans.
Top foreign policy officials from both nations met in Paris Thursday for a joint news conference. France's foreign affairs minister and Germany's foreign minister both agreed the nations should be on the same page. That followed remarks from French Education Minister Jean-Michel Blanqui, who said France would not join the U.S. boycott against Beijing. Germany's new foreign minister says a final decision will be made after further discussion, but she added that Germany will always be in agreement with its European friends. She also called for the EU to adopt a joint stance. Just one day before, International Olympic Committee President Thomas Bach championed what he described as political neutrality. That comment came after the UK and Canada joined the diplomatic boycott of the Beijing Olympics, following the US, Australia, and New Zealand. China responded with apparent aggression on Thursday. Its foreign ministry warned that Australia, the UK, and the US will pay a price for their so-called mistaken acts. The ministry also referred to the boycott as political manipulation, using the Olympics as a platform. But Beijing seems to be sending mixed signals, as it has also said it doesn't care whether foreign officials will attend. One Australian senator drew attention to the contradiction, pointing out that it's like somebody saying, "I'm not going to come to your birthday party," and then you respond by saying, "Well, I wasn't going to invite you anyway." He called China's response childish, and said it once again puts Chinese diplomacy in a very poor light.
Threats have become a reality. China last month vowed to retaliate against Lithuania for allowing Taiwan to open a de facto embassy, and they meant it. Now the Lithuanian Confederation of Industrialists says China is targeting some multinational companies that buy goods from Lithuanian suppliers. The confederation represents thousands of Lithuanian companies. A senior Lithuanian official told Reuters that the companies were told to cut ties with Lithuania or be shut out of the Chinese market. China downgraded its diplomatic ties with Lithuania last month, after Taiwan opened a representative office there. The communist regime views self-governed Taiwan as its territory and has stepped up pressure on countries to downgrade their relations with the island. Lithuania's direct trade with China is modest, but Lithuania's economy is based on exports, and the country is home to hundreds of companies that make products such as furniture, food, and clothing, and sell to China. The Lithuanian official says some companies already canceled contracts with Lithuanian suppliers. Lithuania is looking at setting up a fund to offer financial support to local companies facing Chinese retaliation. The government is now talking with those companies. As a member of the European Union, Lithuania has also appealed to the European Commission for support. The European Commission responded in a statement saying the EU was ready to stand up against all types of political pressure from China. It adds that China's coercive measures have an impact on the EU's overall relations with China. On Wednesday, the EU issued a new proposal that would allow it to retaliate against economic pressures. It is called an anti-coercion instrument, and it would punish countries like China for attempting to influence European policy through unfair trade pressure. The Lithuanian official says China is also curtailing exports to Lithuania for goods such as foodstuffs, lasers, furniture and clothing. But the official adds that Lithuania will not bow to pressure. He says what we decide to do by calling Taiwan Taiwan is up to Lithuania, not Beijing. U.S. lawmakers heard from experts on Tuesday on how the Chinese regime uses economic coercion to get what it wants. NTD's Jim Battaglini takes a look.
The Congressional Executive Commission on China is looking into how the Chinese regime uses economic coercion to silence critics and achieve its political goals around the world. Experts testified at a hearing Tuesday. Senior fellow Zach Cooper from the American Enterprise Institute says China's economic coercion is becoming more frequent, more targeted, and more explicit.
We list at the moment 67 cases of economic coercion by China against companies and individuals and countries in the last decade, most in the last few years.
Senior strategy and research associate Jenny Wong from the Human Rights Foundation says multinational companies pay huge amounts to appease the Chinese regime and secure access to the Chinese market.
In March 2021, Swedish apparel brand H&M faced a boycott in China for simply releasing a statement of concern about Uyghur forced labor. The company lost approximately $74 million in sales for the quarter ending May 31st this year.
So how can the U.S. curb the CCP's economic coercion? As a first step, Wang suggests approving legislation to establish the China Censorship Monitor and Action Group.
Congress should mandate greater transparency among American companies by introducing legislation that would require them to publicly report their respective exposures to China.
Bonnie Glaser from the German Marshall Fund of the United States suggests banding together with like-minded countries, among other things.
The most effective defense against trade coercion is to diversify trade relationships. The U.S. should identify sectors which are overly dependent on Chinese markets on both the export and import sides, and therefore vulnerable to coercive trade practices.
Glaser also says American companies should have plans in place to respond to potential Chinese coercion. Jim Battaglini, NTD News.
The biggest leverage the CCP has is China's huge market with 1.4 billion people. On one hand, they can be potential consumers. On the other hand, they can be a stable supply of cheap labor for foreign manufacturers. China is just one step away from North Korea when it comes to press freedom. That's one of the conclusions from a new report by Reporters Without Borders. NTD's Paris correspondent David Vives spoke with one of the authors of the report.
The situation for journalists in China is getting progressively worse. That's according to a new report released Tuesday by non-profit organization Reporters Without Borders, or RSF, titled The Great Leap Backwards of Journalism in China. The study highlights the Chinese regime reaching new heights in the suppression of information.
The Chinese regime is currently designing a model of society that is based against journalism.
Alviani says 10 years ago, it was still possible for journalists to publish independent reports from the country. But today, he says, Beijing is extending its control over all subjects and ranks only slightly above North Korea in press freedom.
There have been increased pressure and control on the mainstream media and also a very violent campaign against individual journalists and bloggers.
According to the RSF report, the regime uses sophisticated surveillance technologies to suppress information.
Now the regime is trying to suppress the possibility for the public to comment on information and to share information on the social media. So after having suppressed the producers of information, the regime is now trying to suppress the receivers of information.
In order to obtain and renew their press cards, journalists must download a spy app called Study the Great Nation. According to a German cybersecurity firm, the app could enable the collection of personal information without the user's knowledge, Among other features, it would have the capability to modify files, download applications, make phone calls, and turn on the device's microphone.
It is known that this app can be used to spy on the cell phone contents of the journalists. So journalists in China who download this app basically don't have any more privacy on their smartphone.
According to RSF, at least 127 journalists and press defenders are now in jail in China, a dozen of whom are in life-threatening situations. David Vives, NTD News.
Leaders of the free world are meeting virtually today and tomorrow for the Summit for Democracy, a summit hosted by the U.S. Washington says it's rallying nations against rising authoritarian rule. NTD's Jessica Beatty has the details.
President Biden kicked off the virtual Summit for Democracy Thursday morning with over 100 world leaders.
Democracy doesn't happen by accident. We have to renew it with each generation. And this is an urgent matter on all our parts, in my view.
Washington says it hopes the two-day summit will be a boost for global democracy, threatened by an increase in authoritarian rulers. The State Department's top official for democracy says the event comes at a critical time.
Make no mistake, we're at a moment of democratic reckoning, when the greatest challenges we face cross borders, regions, and domains of expertise.
Earlier this year, Biden said he'd face down authoritarian forces led by China and Russia. Neither country was invited to the summit. U.S. officials promising a year of action will follow. Earlier this week, Biden threatened economic sanctions against Russia to dissuade it from invading Ukraine. And American diplomats have committed to boycott next year's Winter Olympic Games in China over the regime's human rights abuses. The House also voting Wednesday to ban all goods from China's Xinjiang region over concerns about forced labor. It passed by an overwhelming 428-1. Jessica Beatty, NTD News.
Is communist China more democratic than the U.S.? Beijing says yes. But ironically, just days ago, Chinese authorities disqualified a number of independent candidates from running in an election through some unorthodox tactics. Here are the details.
Days after Beijing claimed China is more democratic than the U.S., reports say independent candidates running for local election were stripped of their eligibility. Campaigning as an independent in China means running as someone without a background in politics and without backing by the Chinese Communist Party, compared to the majority of candidates which are selected or appointed by the party. Many independent candidates are civilians, workers, students, or professors, running on platforms aimed at improving policy for their communities. But many also take heat from the communist regime. In southwestern China's Chongqing, three of the four independent candidates running for this year's Communist Party Congress were disqualified ahead of the election. One of them, Tang Jingzhou, told NTD that authorities dismissed her eligibility seemingly without cause.
The rules required me to collect 10 signatures to apply. I have a good reputation in the community and quickly collected dozens of signatures to back me up. But they told me only 8 of them were acceptable, thus making me lose my eligibility.
Tang says for such an important election, virtually no notice or publicity of any kind was publicized in the local community, adding she was made to figure out the process of running for office for herself. Authorities disqualified her in November, but she still went to vote in early December. At the polls, she asked questions about the election process, like are the top candidates selected, are voter panel discussions held beforehand, and why didn't the chosen candidates meet with the voters? But her concerns went unanswered.
I said they didn't do their due diligence. I was questioning them, and then several police came and surrounded me. They accused me of disrupting the election and urged me to leave.
Besides Tang, another two candidates were also forced to quit, Han Liang and Xiao Zhenyi. Back in November, when Han was trying to collect the needed signatures to apply as a candidate, local authorities blocked him from leaving his home. Xiao's application was turned down for failing what authorities call their political screening. Wang Chengkang, another independent candidate, made it through that screening, but tells NTD that she's being strictly monitored.
Whenever I say something online, someone will immediately approach me and give me a warning to stop.
Han says authorities jeopardize the general election process, describing that they often choose their own candidates that conform to their guidelines and block the independents from running. Han suspects this happens out of fear that if elected, independents would scrutinize the regime's policies.
A jaw-dropping article from Chinese state media is sending shockwaves on the Chinese internet. State-controlled media outlet China Report published an editorial asking Communist Party members to have three kids. That says the country is seeing the consequences of its one-child policy in the past decades. China's fertility rate, which was just 1.3 child per woman in 2020, is on par with aging societies like Japan and Italy. The article said that no party member can, for this or that subjective or objective reasons, not get married or not have children, nor can they have only one or two children for such reasons. The implementation of the three-child birth policy is a responsibility and obligation of every party member to fulfill the country's population development. It added that admittedly some party members are no longer able to have children due to their age and health, but they can actively take an initiative to educate, guide, enable their own family members or people around them to actively and consciously implement the three-child policy. The article told party members, never be oblivious and let your family or people around you remain unmarried or childless. And never be oblivious and let your family or people around you have only one or two children for whatever excuses. Numerous major Chinese outlets, including other state media, reposted the article before it got taken down. It also went viral on Chinese social media Weibo. One netizen commented, "This shocked my value system. So if you don't get married or have three kids, you should be condemned by history." Another lamented about how much pressure ordinary Chinese people already face. For one family, the husband and wife have to raise three kids and take care of their parents. That's four seniors. They have to go to work at 8 a.m., leave the office at 9 p.m. It strains their energy. And then there's a million yuan mortgage that they have to pay. I should rather stay single. Yet another wrote, "I just submitted my application to join the party this October. Now I'm hesitating." And one netizen commented, "I never agreed with the centrally planned fertility policy. Having children is a basic human right, and no party or organization should have the right to use legal means to interfere with it." The vendor had everything taken away from him. This is what Chinese street vendors face almost on a daily basis. That is, abuse by China's para-police, known as chengguan. The vendor cried in despair as they confiscated all his goods. The vendor was left with nothing. Those police lookalikes are technically not police officers. Chengguan can be translated into urban management officers. Their job is to manage street vendors and keep the roads clean for traffic. But their management style can be notorious. Over the years, China has reported multiple cases of chengguan beating street vendors to death. Chinese authorities hardly investigate such cases of brutality, if ever. Is Walmart pulling out of China? The world's largest retailer appears to further downsize its footprint in China. Walmart reportedly closed four stores in mainland China on Tuesday, and a total of 80 stores in the country in the past 4 years. Among them was Walmart's first store in China, opened in 1996. But a quarter century after it entered China, Walmart is now at a crossroads. The company's revenue in China's hypermarket sector had fallen from top two in 2011 to fourth place, the lowest ranking since it entered the Chinese market. In 2021, Walmart's sales in China accounted for just over 2% of its global revenue. Walmart reportedly said they closed the stores because the leases expired. But many suspect that cutthroat competition from local players like e-commerce giant Alibaba may also play a role. In addition to Walmart, multinational retailers such as Francis Carrefour are also struggling in China. According to media reports, Carrefour has closed 14 stores in China in the first 2 months of this year alone. In 2019, Japanese department store Takashimaya pulled out from China and planned to relocate its business to Southeast Asia. Economic experts told the Epoch Times that China's retail sector is suffering from a slowing economy. Demand for goods with a Made in Germany sticker on it seems to have gone soft, and this is partly because of weaker demand from China. New figures out Monday show Germany's industrial orders taking a surprise tumble. They were down 6.9% on the month in October, when analysts had forecast little change. The drop was driven by a big decline in overseas orders. They were down 13% on the month. Demand from countries outside Europe, including China, was particularly weak. The pandemic situation was partly to blame. German exports to China were running weak in October, and Chinese exports to Germany may also face a hard time. German Foreign Minister Annalena Baerbock told a German newspaper last week that the EU should use import curbs as a leverage to put Beijing under pressure. She said it would be a big problem for an exporting country like China, because China has massive interests in the European market. Baerbock cited human rights abuses in China as to why she suggested the policy. She added, silence is not diplomacy. Other German cabinet members have also talked about Chinese imports recently. Back in November, Germany's acting health minister Jens Spahn said Germany was too dependent on face masks and medical precursors from China. Spahn added Germany and the entire European Union should make more trade deals with other countries to reduce their over-reliance on China. The British broadcasting company, or BBC, has invested nearly $200 million in Chinese companies through its pension fund. Financial reports show investments in firms that support China's communist regime. The real figure is likely much higher, as the BBC only reveals its 20 largest investments.
The fund represents the pension investments of 47,000 current and former BBC staff. The Chinese firms in the fund's 20 largest holdings include Alibaba, Tencent, and Pinduoduo. Alibaba and Tencent regularly collaborate with the Chinese regime to carry out internet censorship, allegedly providing surveillance software used against Uyghurs. E-commerce platform Pinduoduo is on a U.S. blacklist after violations of intellectual property rights. Former Tory leader Sir Ian Duncan-Smith says license fee payers would be horrified to know that the money they pay the BBC ends up sustaining a brutal, dictatorial, and violent regime that practices genocide. A BBC spokesman told the Daily Mail the scheme is operationally independent from the BBC and has a wide range of investments with a small proportion of Chinese companies. A responsible investment policy is also in place.
Similar issues also exist in the U.S. Retirement funds have been flowing to Chinese firms for years. The Federal Retirement Thrift Investment Board, a retirement fund of the U.S. government, invests in Chinese stocks through a stock market index. The index includes various companies from different countries, and about 8% of the companies are from China. The fund administers $735 billion of retirement fund for over 6 million federal employees and service members. Last year, then-President Trump tried to restructure the board of the agency to stop the practice, but the Senate blocked his nominees. President Biden later pulled back Trump's nominees. A woman in China's Sichuan province died from the H5N6 strain of avian influenza last month. A regional health bureau said this week it's the latest human fatality from the lethal disease. The 54-year-old woman developed symptoms on November 17th and was admitted to the hospital on November 21st. She died 2 days later. According to a statement from the Macau Health Bureau, she had been exposed to dead poultry before the onset of illness. The number of people in China infected with H5N6 bird flu this year has jumped, raising concern among experts who say a previously circulating strain appears to have changed and may be more infectious to humans. Of 26 infections reported by the Chinese regime's various government departments this year, most have been in Sichuan province, though cases have also been reported in neighboring provinces. And that's all for today's China in Focus. Thanks for watching and see you tomorrow.